In this last segment, we talked about two topics. First, who was Angeline Dube, John Dube's second wife? And also, what it meant for her, Professor Meer, to be banned under apartheid in South Africa.
If you could talk a little bit about your memories of Angeline Dube, the late Mrs. Dube.
Yeah.
What kind of person was she?
Very impressive, very dignified, full of authority. She was a leader in her own right. And there she conducted her meetings with all the European American missionaries would come and visit her. But she knew how to conduct herself. She was always a kind of an imperial figure. Nobody could dominate her. She had a tremendous African presence, you know. Rather like Winnie Mandela. She is very imperious also. Very humble.
Yes.
Very much of the people. But she knows when to be humble.
Okay.
And when
to show the authority.
Yeah,
interesting.
To show her pride. That's another woman, very much, they were rather similar.
She
Mrs.
Winnie.
Yes, and Winnie.
Interesting.
Both
like a forerunner, yeah.
Very proud of their African heritage. And putting that to the fore.
That's right.
And bringing it effectively when necessary.
That's right. Bear on things.
No white woman could go and patronize Mrs. Dube.
Really?
She would patronize them, but they would not be able to patronize her.
Wow.
Whether it was Gwendolyn Carter or whoever.
Okay, that's right. And again, you mentioned a story. I'd like us to evoke it again, which I found very interesting. You know, when you were banned. Okay, first of all, if we could talk about what you mean to be banned. And also, I know, but for the listener, the young, who don't know what meant to be banned. And what
well, I got banned because of my work in Cato Manor.
So what was banning in practical terms?
Banning, you see, the nationalists had various ways of counteracting any kind of resistance. And if they saw that a person, of course they had the very big, wide network of special branch police.
That's right.
And they spied on you. They attended our meetings. The ANC, all the political meetings were invaded by the special branch who listened to the speeches and made notes. And then that was taken to their headquarters where the decision was taken who should be punished.
Okay.
And the first punishment was to ban you. That meant that you could not be in any social gathering. And you couldn't be in any educational institution. Or for that matter, you couldn't be near any factory. So you couldn't influence pupils or influence workers in any way. Because these were the two forces that the Nats knew would bring them down. And indeed they did, as history proved. This government became very clever. They saw the Achilles heel. And so they set up a government of what they called unity. But there's no unity, really. So they incorporated the trade unions into their government. And in this way, they thought that they would appropriate it they would appropriate the force and power of the workers. But yesterday and today...
You mean today, exactly, yes.
The workers have shown...
Mm-hmm. That they still have the independence.
Yes, and their power. And they will, they can and they will use it against the government if the government does not deliver the Freedom Charter to them. So this is what it is all about.
Interesting. So when you were banned, it means that you couldn't get near any the children and the workers.
So no were, schools, I'm cut off from schools,
so you were banned.
Workers, from all gatherings. Gathering meant if you, the two of you
yes.
were together
yes.
talking or drinking tea
yes.
and I joined you,
then
I had breached. Entered a gathering and breached my banning order. So I could be arrested and brought to court.
Really?
And I was on two occasions. But my lawyers managed to beat them at their game.
To get you out. Interesting. So you were saying that, you know, you still had ways of going around this banning in order and making...
Well, I wanted to build there at Oshlange. So I had to go there and see how work is progressing. So I would go, every day I made a trip to Oshlange. I used to dress up like a poor white woman, wear a big hat, put on a pair of slacks and old blouse, drive to Oshlange, do my supervisory work
yes.
and return home. And one day I got caught.
I see. You got caught one day.
Yeah. And I was taken to court. Now, my lawyer was Ismail Muhammad, who became the first judge president of the Democratic South Africa. He was a very clever lawyer.
Really?
So he defended me.
Interesting.
And his first argument was, you see, I was not allowed outside. My banning order also meant that I could not be outside the boundary of Durban. And being in Oshlange,
yes.
I was in Inanda, which is outside
yes.
the Durban boundary.
Exactly.